So much for series drive.
This, so what, which?
Yes, there's, in 2010 there was a survey.
Yeah.
What was the result of the survey?
Well,
that there's a problem?
The design of the survey was done by people in the American Institute of Food. The design of the next survey will involve probably people in social sciences.
But is there any results? So, because it was done in 2010, there should be some results out now, right?
Yeah. This survey, which was done in 2010, is the basis of the work done by the conference on, International Conference on Women in Science, that happens every 3 years. They reviewed what came from the survey and they decided how, in every country, they were going to try and push this forward. So that they set up working teams in each country. The survey was to get kind of global information, but the actions, again, local information back in each country.
I'm somewhat surprised that there is no international pattern, because I mean the gender gap is basically happening everywhere. I mean, it's not a problem of
but it's country. Not, it's not uniform. It's not the amount of gender gap, the difference in terms of women in various different scientific disciplines. This was about a gender gap in physics. That differs from country to country. It's not uniform.
Okay.
So the acting on it requires different actions.
Acting on it means that there is a goal. So what's the goal?
Half the population of women, why shouldn't half the population
of physicists? So you want, for instance, that you have less women in biology or medicine? Because there is a certain conservation principle.
No, no, it's not a conservation principle. It doesn't work like that.
It's not sure.
I'm sorry. There is a conservation principle.
It's going to be.
You can't say that.
The conservation principle in terms of women, but it's not a conservation principle in terms of the women that become scientists. You could attract more women into science.
So the goal is to attract more women to science.
Attract more women into physics. That's the goal.
Why?
Because physics is rather low compared to the others. Okay. And so generally, not
so
always.
Actually,
not all
the
countries.
Theory is that if it is low, it is bad.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I think it's a wrong approach to see it this way. I think you should more say that.
I completely disagree, but I mean.
Yeah, but I
just wanted to know.
Okay. See it differently. I think the question is more: is there some systematic or like social hurdle for women to study physics, in particular, let's say, because we're not talking about physics. And if there is something, you should try to remove this, because in principle, women should have the same rights and the same. Way to choose their piece of research than the men. Mm-hmm. And this you should identify and question and try to fight against it. In the end, if women don't want to study physics, of course they have the right not to study physics, right? Yeah. They should not be forced to study physics. But the question is if there's something which stops them from studying physics, yeah, which is not their free choice.
Well, I think it is a whole very big, very important issue. I think you're right. Even women have shown talents in math or in physics when they were young, which is the statistics of data. When we look at the elementary school or middle school, the women, the girls actually do equally well as the boys in the math or the science. But sometimes you go into the high school or even college, the population is going to decline. And so we end up about 18 or 20% women studying science or physics nowadays. The average.
But
in some country like the one we just visited in Brazil, I was very shocked to learn. For physics, the men and women in physics and nuclear science or energy physics, they actually are around 45%. compared to men. So I was shocked. Why? Brazil, women is done right. So then I talked to Alenka afterwards.
There you go.
Yeah. She actually gave me a very interesting insight. Sorry to take some time here. Have you ever talked to her about this? She actually told me this particularly high ratio of women is related to, in her view, the social phenomena with Brazil itself, special situation. Turns out in Brazil, most of the young couple, after marriage, they stay with their parents, or parents live with them. So take care of the baby or the child. So actually, most women scientists can continue her career.
Okay, that's it.
Yeah, without worrying about anything. The parents or the grandparents will just take care of the kids for them. So there's very high ratio for them to choose science and continue with science. That's what she shared with me.
A country which has very high rates of women doing physics, at least at university level, is Brunei. Something like 65% of the physics students are women.
I mean, there cannot be so many.
Not many. There's not many.
And
I don't know why it's special. I visited there only for a day. Learn enough about it to discover ways.
So it is true, most girls are doing quite well in science, but until they reach age about 18 or 20, they decide this is social pressure, or the pressure they have to raise the family, the children, they're starting to consider and face the reality. They have to shift away. But now, if there's such obstacles, I think you can help to remove them or make them a little less, that should be important.
Let's not classify it as a holistic.
No,
that's just that's a more general question. It's a very interesting discussion, and a very worthwhile one. Another one which I think is a big problem, much bigger than most people would talk about, is the question of use of various numerical measures to discover whether or not we're doing a good job. And they're basically things that are put together so that people don't have to think. They can just look at some numbers and decide whether things are going well or not. And I want to have a look at some data. Think about these. I won't get you to make some guesses. You'll never guess 3 and 4 anyway. Just think about them for a moment. These countries have just the most visited publications in the last 20 years, in the last 1 year. And these countries have the most citations per paper in that period. Probably you can guess number one.
US.
Yes. US?
Right.
What about number two?
China.
Exactly. Both those are right. I say you'll never guess 3 and 4. And I'll show you the answers. US with over 1 million papers in 20 years. China with almost 80,000 in 2016. Citations per paper. Svalbard. A little while north of Norway. I don't know why it counts as an extra country, as a separate country in the statistics, but in last year they had one paper that scored 7 citations. That's not a lot of citations for a paper, but if you have 8,000 papers, and a lot of them are scoring 1 or 9 citations, and 2 or 3 are scoring hundreds, then the number of citations per paper in China is about 3. So, and which country had the most citations per paper in the last 20 years? That's the Faroe Islands. Again, it's not a country, it's a separate administrative region of Denmark up in the North Sea. And in that period, it had published 11 papers. And 750 citations. One of those papers scored 680 of those. statistics, you can get almost any answer you want.
So the 750 is per paper or is the total?
Total citations.
Total.
Total citations. Citations per paper is around 80.
Where is that country?
Faroe Islands.
Not necessarily North Sea.
It's in the North Sea between Norway and Iceland.
Iceland.
It's near Iceland. It's an island which is administered by Denmark, but it's a separate administrative region. In the same way that Svalbard is an island administered by Norway, which is a separate administrative
region.
The definition of a country is a bit elastic for these people producing the statistics.
It's a hell of a conference. It's a beautiful place.
So why the papers?
I haven't been to either. I was quite close to Svalbard a few months ago, but didn't actually get to Svalbard. I was in Franz Josef Land instead.
So that paper received 600 citations. Is it really good paper or some kind of special case?
I haven't been able to find out what the paper is.
Maybe it's not really a normal citation.
Was produced back around in the 90s.
Okay. Or some kind of controversy or something.
Could have been something about, I don't know, cosmic rays or something. There's a lot of cosmic ray research going on in that part of the world at one stage.
But for the country, who are looking at these numbers? So you're using this number to judge out which
well, it's not scientific. Yeah, the reason I looked at these numbers is that I was trying to find which countries all the members of APA, and I was trying to find which countries were producing the most physical papers. Mm-hmm. And then somebody said, well, maybe you should try and figure out what the published papers are. Mm-hmm. The only measure I could get was citations per paper, because that produced these crazy statistics.
But then if you use it for individuals, international wide,
it would be different. Yeah. That's too tiny. This is the number of papers last year with China at the top, US next, Germany, Russia, Japan, UK, India, France, Italy, Korea, Spain, Canada, Poland. This was a surprise that Iran has seen. That's the height. That is actually a member of IUPAC. Switzerland, Australia, Brazil.
Some included. Hmm? Some included. Switzerland. I'm Switzerland.
Right.
Some included or not?
Is some included? I don't know.
Okay.
but then CERN will also appear in many other countries.
Yeah.
No. Well, I mean, it depends how you count.
It depends how you count. Every country listed in the author list, I think, goes in the paper.
If one paper by Atlas means that it's counting 250 different countries, then the statistics is a problem.
Statistics is always a problem for reasons like that.
That's why I'm asking about
Switzerland,
because we are used to have the two numbers, with and without.
With and without.
Yeah. It's for parts of
the case. If you're doing high energy physics, you would certainly do it
that way. Then that's the point that I talk on that.
So Taiwan is up here, number 19.
That's the total number of the world.
Turkey is the highest number, one that's not a member of IUPAC. It resigned a few years ago. Malaysia is also not in the way, and Ukraine not in the way. So that was the countries. I thought I'd put this, I gave a talk about the work that I've done with Michelle Gandhi on Monday and in part of that I produced the citation analysis of the paper, which was written in 1992, published in 1993. When I looked at this a year ago, there were no citations written in 94 and 95, but the Google Scholar has found some obscure Russian books that actually cited the paper. And the next citation was in 1998, 1996. 1999, 6 years after it was written, published, and that decided to name the paper Arcturus, name of the effect Arcturus. And almost no citations in the book. Around about here we did a little bit more work on it, so that's self-citations. And in 2012 somebody measured it, so then the citation jumped up. It's kind of pleasing that a 25-year-old paper generates so much interest, but it would never appear in any citations, any analysis. Wouldn't contribute to any impact factor. How about this one? For which is Einstein's most cited paper?
Brownian motion.
I don't know whether the centenary of gravitational layers may have made his gravitational paper more cited now. Back in 2005, on the centenary of all his papers, we had a set of public lectures on each of the four papers in Melbourne, and I gave a public lecture on Brownian motion, and I dug out the statistics. I'm still being cited in quite heavily now, largely because it gives you a way of counting, determining the size of the big molecule. Cited in biology papers. And of course, you don't have to cite Einstein's paper for the photograph special or the general of it. And you want people to know what you're doing. Citation counts are statistics, so it's useful to think about what people said about statistics. There's a lovely little book called Dan Blyers and Statistics. And it has this beautiful quotation. There are cultures in which people believe that some objects have magical powers. Anthropologists call these objects fetches. In our society, statistics are a sort of fetch. We tend to regard statistics as though they are magical, so they're something more than mere numbers. We treat them as powerful representations of the truth, and we act as though they distill complexity and confusion of reality into simple facts. We use statistics to convert complicated social problems into more easily understood estimates, percentages, and rates. Statistics direct our concern. They show us what we ought to worry about and how much we ought to worry. In a sense, the social problem becomes a statistic. And because we treat statistics as true and incontrovertible, they achieve a kind of fetish-like magical control about how we view social problems. We think of statistics as facts that we discover, not numbers we create. Statistics is something we produce. And there was a nice analysis 20 years ago of things like using citation counts to judge people or whatever, league tables. And if you're using this type of statistics to generate rankings, you ought to do three things correct. You ought to make sure the data is properly collected and there are no inadequacies in the data, like the one you were talking about a moment ago, and there's no messing about with them. And the statistical analysis should be good and proper, and in fact you should start with a model. And we should talk about the uncertainty in the presentation of your results. You'll notice that none of those are taken into account when people start thinking about the citations. And the comparisons are of great public interest, but careful attention to limitations is both vital and likely to be ignored. Adjusted outcomes are in any way valid measures of institutional quality is one issue, and while analysts should also be aware of the potential effects of the results in terms of future behavioural changes by institutions and individuals seeking to improve their subsequent rating. So, completely independent of what's been happening recently in terms of counting citations to judge us, people have been setting up what should be done when you're using statistics and most of that has been absolutely ignored. And so trying to produce numbers that is partly a result of trying to say that judgments based made by people are subjective judgments, and we need something that is objective. And the message, the underlying message, is that these measures are not in any sense objective. And people need to worry about whether they're being analysed properly and whether there's any proven quality of the analysis. And an extension of that, even worse, are using impact factors on journals as a way of judging the quality of anybody's work. The beautiful article in the notices of the American Mathematical Society by Arnold and Fowler called Nefarious Numbers. And it points out all the problems we all know, impact factor distribution citations in terms of quality, it's just one statistic and a very crude one at that, and a flawed one, distribution of citations from paper to paper in the journal is highly flawed, meaningful journal test to be misleading, impact factor refers only to journal citations for the first 2 years that people are mathematicians, so they're worried that in mathematics 90% of citations will paper occur after the first 2 years and just be missed out. And the database coming from ISI contains errors and bias in journals and many confounding factors are ignored. Multiple authorship, self-citations. So why is it used so much? It requires no thought. Felt to be objective, but in my view, a major reason why impact factors are used so much these days is that they're a marketing tool for the journals. The journals that have high impact factors like Science and Nature market the fact that you should be publishing in high impact journals. They also give a beautiful tutorial on how to increase your journal's impact factor, and they mention a specific journal explicitly, but I won't mention the names. The editor of People Connected to him wrote reviews and other papers, citing papers in the 2 year window, which contributes to the impact. They wrote huge numbers of such papers. And that 70% of the citations give the journal an impact factor twice that of the next highest in the field. The work done by the editor and his mates. And so many citations that the editor was regarded as a rising star because of all the citations in the paper. That he gently persuaded Tristan to make arms of his mates to do the citations. And I just want to concentrate on the last two here. Rewards are wrongly distributed, the scientific literature and enterprise are distorted, and cynicism grows, or should grow, it doesn't seem to be much. And we must bring the same level of integrity to the evaluation of these research products as we bring to the papers that we write. And one of my friends, Tim Davis, wrote a lovely article in Australian Physics earlier this year about some sharp practices by authors and editors to try and increase their visibility. He gave two examples, one from Science and one from Nature, and I'll just reproduce the one from Science. The title of the paper was Light Propagation with Phase Discontinuities, Generalized Laws of Reflection and Refraction. And talk about normal instruments. Wrong. about a beam of normal incidence and emphasised this diffracted beam, because we want a diffraction grating over here, and he called it a generalised law of refraction. And the device that he was using is what's well known as a diffraction grating, in fact, a glazed diffraction grating. And Jim said his last count, his paper had almost 1,100 citations, and Thomson Reuters put the work in the top 1% of its field. It's a, but the work is 140 years old. This effect was written down by Raleigh in 1874. And it was demonstrated by Wood in 1910. So science managed to publish as a new piece of science a paper reporting something that 140 years old. It was absolutely, because it looked, sounded good, looked like a good thing, no incentive for them. I don't know what happened to the referendum process, but anyway. And he produced another one out of Nature, which is very similar. And we've tried to persuade Ipsu to take up the problem as one of its research integrity conferences. And to, so far to no avail. I think that at the moment they've been devoting much of their effort to the merger. Maybe we'll get somewhere. But it gets even worse. But now if you can look on the web and find people that will count the number of Facebook references or Twitter references to your papers. So, other ways of mentioning, trying to measure the impact is becoming more, trying to stop the world. And finally, sorry, I'm going over time, I wanted to mention the problem of fake conferences and fake journals. Our conferences are perhaps the most visible thing we do. But, and you have to wonder why IDCAP supported conferences are so important, since we give out so much, so little money these days. Back many years ago, we used to give out substantial amounts of money for the conferences that we supported. One famous conference that we supported was the Chapel Hill conference on gravitation, which was supported by IDCAP, and almost all the money for it came from IDCAP. Didn't do that these days. Conferences get very little money per conference, but it's still important. In fact, I was at a conference which we had supported, but we'd given no money to. And the organisers made a big thing in their summary of it about saying how that IUPAP was a sponsor of it. So afterwards I said, you know, why don't you make such a big fuss about IUPAP because we gave you no money? And there was a conference in Japan, they said, if you hadn't supported us, we would not have got any money from the Science Council. Right. So, so it does provide a way of telling which conference is the real one. We actually get quite a lot of people asking us that question. And so, an International Conference on High Energy Physics, if you Google that, you'll find International Conference on High Energy Physics in 2016 and one in 2017. In the field, you know that these conferences happen every 2 years, so one of them has to be a fake conference. I didn't know about these until I went to dinner with somebody in London. I wanted to talk to Ed Hines about some physics, and he was telling me about the fact of fake conferences. And his conference on atomic physics had been taken over by another organisation. The organisation that does a lot of this is the World Academy for Science, Technology and Engineering. And I think I'll put this on the next slide. they have a series of conferences, they have five conferences or more going on in the same place at the same time. All of them with names, like I check other names, but well known conferences. Unfortunately, the conference names are not copyrighted, so we can't take any action against them. And a few years ago, they had this suite of conferences in Melbourne, so I went along to see what's happening. And couldn't get very far because I didn't pay the registration fee, which was hundreds of dollars for a two-day conference. But I did hear a big angry confrontation for somebody at the registration desk who wanted his money back because of them saying, this is not a real conference. On the other hand, quite a lot of people seemed very happy to be there. They were, their institution was paying them to go to Melbourne. They were having a nice time in Melbourne, and they spent maybe half an hour at the conference or half a day at the conference. And so I think fake conferences and fake journals, and I frequently get emails from people inviting me to go on the editorial board of their journal. I've got nothing to do with anything that I do. You know, they just want to set up a journal and make some money. And I think, a big problem. I'm not sure how we can do anything about it except to keep publicity going. There are big sites that tell you about fake journals. One of them got shut down recently, I don't quite know why. So, there's a lot of problems in international physics. So there's lots of work still to do. If you want to help join us in some way, we depend on volunteers, about 600 or so I tried to count. A lot of work's been done. Thank you for inviting me here, listening to me, and providing some interesting commentary as we make sure.
Thank you for the very interesting talk. I think we don't usually hear about these companies. More questions?
I was wondering, what is your plan to fight against this abuse of citation indices? I mean, from my point of view, I'm a young scientist. For me, it's about competition. I have the feeling if you want to get invited for a faculty interview, you have to have at least 1,000 citations, otherwise you have no chance. And, I mean, I can see it. If I look at the shortlist, people have as many citations, but not all of those people have the citations because they're good scientists, but they have the citations because they wrote papers with big bosses and always get this number of citations. So, I mean, from my point of view, this is clearly about competition, and it distorts the market, and people become faculty positions which should not get these faculty positions because there are better scientists out there. So what is the plan? How do you want to fight against this?
I've never been in a commission where the shortlist was made but on the basis of citations.
But I mean, it's from the outside, it looks very weird. And I mean, I even wrote applications where they asked for the journals and the impact factors. And if they ask in the application for impact factors, that looks weird. It doesn't look like they want to hire me because I'm a good scientist, because I care about my science.
They want to hire you because you will provide papers for the institution in journals with high impact factors, because the government that is giving the institution money is looking for that.
Yes.
And so far, we've tried to work through, as I mentioned, through the conference at the time, but we haven't got very far with that. This is not systematic, but whenever I get a chance to talk to people who are in a position to to hire people, to put people up for prizes, to put people up for international academies and all of that, that I make the point that, like I've been making here, and tell them that this is not what they should be doing. They should be trying to assess what, how good the person is. They need to seek opinions from people that are doing the best way of doing it. And they need to read and think about it. But so far, I actually know no systematic way of doing it. You can write articles that complain about it. You will never get one published in Science or Nature. and we do some of that some. It's to have an impact, but what you're doing.
I would like to make a comment on this, if you give me 2 minutes.
Yeah.
I believe that the problem is not in the hiring process of individual people in committees in charge of hiring one person. If you are in a committee where you want to hire one person, a lot of other things come to mind to the people in the committee. Citations or numbers, but there are lots of other problems of ideas that come in the discussion. But now I think the problem is more at the level of funding agencies than at the level of individual hirings. Because of a simple effect that usually a funding agency has to distribute money into many different directions and fields, so you have a difficulty to compare the performance. So there is a trend to put, to define criteria for what is good and what is bad in every field. And there has been in the last years in Europe, at least because I know better Europe, I know that UPAP knows a lot better the American system than the rest of the world. But in Europe, it has been clearly a trend of the last years that